Before heading to the video, if you haven't subscribed the channel, do subscribe it and don't forget to click the bell icon for the latest update notification. If you like the video, do like, comment and share. Stay tuned with learnbay.co. Happy learning.
Not a very tough topic, easy topic. You will not get any difficulty in understanding this. So we'll start sentimental analysis. So again, a part of text analytics and a way how to analyze the sentiment. So I'll just give you some examples and I'll just give you one scenario and case study. We'll discuss about how to do the sentimental analysis. Okay, so we will be keep on discussing. So predicting sentiments by topic and intelligent restaurant review system. So we will try to do the prediction, some recommendation system for restaurants review. So for example, it's a big day and I want to book at a Japanese restaurant. Seattle has many 5-star, 4-star sushi restaurants. What are people saying about the food and the ambience? So now generally what happens when you go for any restaurant or if you book food from any restaurant, you look onto the reviews and ratings of the Swiggy, Zomato, these kind of apps. So what people are saying about the reviews. Now what happens? Few years back, it was very easy to go through the reviews available for the particular restaurants. But now what happens? There are millions of reviews available for only a single restaurant. Now it is very difficult to find out, to judge a particular restaurant on the basis of reviews, reading all the reviews. And probably suppose if you want to find out, okay, where Chola Bhatura I am getting best. So what people are saying about the Chola Bhatura in this particular restaurant. So now, if that particular reviews you want to identify, so that is kind of a tricky problem, tricky thing to handle. So now this is where sentimental analysis comes into picture, which takes and parse all the reviews and do one rating and give one sort of rating about that. Okay, your 90% of the reviews are positive, 10% are negative, or 10% are neutral. So these kind of systems we have available into Python and machine learning area, which we will be seeing. So we will see how we can do that. So some sample reviews are: watching the chef create incredible edible art made the experience very unique. My wife, so this is a thumbs up. So it's a positive review. My wife tried their ramen and it was pretty forgettable. Thumbs down. It is a negative review. All the sushi was delicious, easily best sushi in the Seattle. Double thumbs up. So this guy is saying again, it is a positive review. Now, leave about all machine learning, leave about all text analytics or whatever we have learned till now. Let's just discuss simple. Now these sample reviews are given to you. How you will identify that which reviews are positive or which reviews are negative? Suppose simple Python code you have to write where you have to decide, okay, if this review is positive or this review is negative. So what all things you can implement into Python, simple codes I'm asking, no machine learning is required. Just simply you tell me how you can write a script to extract positive review or negative review. Yes.
I will have a set with the unique values of vocabulary, positive
keyword.
Keywords and negative keywords.
And what, like, pretty, very unique,
oh,
and best,
okay,
can be filtered out.
Okay. So basically I can write a Python script, and what I can do, I can extract the reviews on the basis of good words or bad words, which is a correct analysis. So now what happens? I can create probably two lists. One list is good word list and another list is bad word list. And I will be keep on checking each review if any word is belonging to this particular thing. We will be just making it as a positive or negative. Now, okay, so this, now you have identified the okay, positive and negative review, that it is a positive review or negative review. Now, similarly, in our available packages, the people from Stanford University and Cambridge University, they have created one dictionary, which is called as good bad word dictionary. Okay. Now what happens, they have captured all the good words or bad words into this dictionary. For example, good, okay, best and worst and awesome, okay, awful, or for example, forgettable, Okay, excellent. Okay, right. So excellent. So now they have marked them as this is positive, this is positive, this is negative, this is negative, this is negative. Okay, this is positive, this is negative, then this is positive. So they have created this dictionary already for you. Now, if you will search on Google, you will get this dictionary online available. One CSV file is available. That CSV file you can download, and then you can read this CSV file into a data frame, and you can just parse your reviews, and you can just find out if my review is positive or negative. Now, let me give you another scenario. So, okay, so let me take something. Okay, so I love this car. Okay, from suppose Tata. What kind of review it is, positive or negative?
Positive.
Positive review. Okay, so another review. Suppose I went to a restaurant. So in a restaurant, I took suppose some dish. Okay. So dish was awesome. But ambience was bad. What kind of review it is?
It has both components, positive and negative.
Mixed.
So now mixed it is what? How you know you will segregate this kind of? So I only need to find out positive review or negative review. How do we you will segregate it? It's a mixed thing.
Some scores for positive. And score for positive.
So basically what happens, this is the problem. Okay, this is one of the problem. Like, okay, if you are getting multiple words, like, okay, probably one more I'm adding here. So staff was courteous. Now what kind of review it is? Now what is happening? Awesome, courteous and bad. So two positive words are there and one negative word is there. So I'll say, okay, it's a positive review. So I can count the number of good, bad words and I can actually handle this kind of problem. So this also we will discuss key how you have to decide. So now one more example I'm giving. Okay. So suppose I love the car.
I have a question. Is there any majority in the positive and the negative? Like, for example, in the last scenario, two positive words was there and one negative, right?
Okay.
But what about if the dish was bad and restaurant was good and the staff was courteous? Then the main thing which represents the resto is a dish, right? And okay. if the main factor is bad, then
okay. So now what happens? Staff was courteous. Okay, now this is something you have to understand. Now what happens? We have discussed into clustering problem. There are some people who are brand loyal. Okay, you give them whatever price you want to give. Okay, you give them shoes into free of cost, but still they will not take it. They will always buy from Puma, Adidas or Nike. There are few people who are price conscious. Okay, they doesn't care whatever is the brand or something. If the price is low, they will only buy your shoes in that case. Now similarly, there are some people who go to a restaurant for eating purpose. There are some people who select a restaurant on the basis of ambience. Okay, see, there are people who sometimes select Absolute Barbecue even though it is costlier, even though food is not that up to the mark, but still people try and go to these restaurants, Absolute Barbecue and Chutney Cheng. Why they go? Ambience. Okay, staff is very courteous. Now few people looks for the service, few people look for the quality. So it depends on different to different people. So you cannot really say, see, this will be when you are saying, okay, people always go for a dish, that is a biased decision. This is you do that. Okay, I do that I always go for a restaurant where the dishes are tasty, but there are people who go for the ambience. There are people who always go to Marriott, who always go to Le Meridien. They will never go into the smaller places. Okay, so that is the difference. So we cannot really say that, okay, a person is always going for a dish purpose. People go for different reasons. People, corporate companies are taking you for generally where the ambience is good. So really there this condition will fail. Does it answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, but I'll just reframe your question. So not reframing, actually it will be a new thing. So let me make you understand now by this example. So I love the car, color is pathetic and tires are worst. Okay, what kind of review it is?
Mixed review.
So can I say two words are coming as negative and one word negative is coming as positive? So I can just give it as a negative now. But there is one more thing. Okay, so you know, in English literature, now we are talking about text analytics, so a lot of English literature we will discuss. So you remember there was something called as degrees in our English grammar. So I forgot this, that one is called a superlative degree, if you remember. So we call it as good, better and best, right? Something like that. You remember in schools that they teach that. So yes or no, you remember or you don't remember?
Yes.
Superlative degrees and all that. Correct. So now what happens, what they say is these superlative degrees, basically the highest score. So best in good, better, best, we give best as the highest weightage. English literature give best as the highest weightage. So similarly, better is having less than best and good is having less than better and best. So now this is something we can use in our review analysis also. So now what can be done? Basically, in a dictionary, whatever dictionary I told you, this is the whole funda which I'm going to tell you now. Now, what they do in your dictionary, they have words. Yes.
Yes.
So we have something called as words: good, best, suppose, awesome, and bad, worst. Okay. Pathetic, like these words are available. Now they give the score also. 2, 3, 4, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4. Okay. Similarly, you have something called as forgettable. So suppose they have given minus 2.5. So now what happens whenever any review will come? I love this car. Okay, and color is suppose pathetic. Now suppose for love I am giving the score as suppose 1. Now what will happen? It will calculate the score. So it will find out how many words: love and pathetic, two words. Now 1 plus minus 4 is equal to 3. Okay, so now this number, sorry, it is minus three. So this number is a negative number. So it will say that the review is negative. Now, even the mixed reviews can be segregated via using this kind of dictionary. Now, this is a dictionary has been created by the people who are sitting into Stanford universities, who are the masters into the English literature language. So they have created this dictionary and they have given the scoring to these words. So you have to directly use this scoring methodology, this dictionary, and you can directly sentimental analysis can be done into your system. So this is the actual fundamental of doing the sentimental analysis. This is the only funda. So this dictionary is implemented internally into the text blob package. So if text blob package you will call directly, it will directly do all these calculations and it will directly give you this answer, that what is the polarity of your reviews. So polarity is nothing but the score. Basically, what is the score? So polarity is the parameter which we use. So this is the method which they internally use to find out what is the score for a particular review, and it will be able to tell you the positivity and negativity into the review. So what happens? So basically, it is nothing but a classifier. So it act as a classifier. So classifier is something which divide data into the two classes. So here you are dividing the data into positive and negative classes. So this is an example for review system where you are passing the reviews. This is a sentiment classifier, and it will tell you positive or negative. So this sentiment classifier I will be showing you today. Now these are the classifier applications. I will come on to this, but before going into that, I want to show you this. So now what happens? First method was list of positive words and list of negative words. You just count the positive and negative word in the sentence. If number of positive words are greater than negative words, then assign the particular class to a review. So now sushi was great, food was awesome, but the service was terrible. So sometimes degree of the numbers comes into picture. That awesome is always bigger than, suppose somebody has given two words, bad and awesome. So awesome is having the higher weightage as compared to bad, because bad is not that bad. Worst might be having equal weightage to awesome. So now what happens when these kind of words comes into picture, then the counting of the words, positive and negative words, will be a problematic situation. So now what happens? So sometimes people are writing, okay, I went to the restaurant and ambience was nice, but food was okay. So okay means I'm not discarding also. Okay, there is a neutral kind of thing. Okay, this food is not that good, but it was okay, not bad also. So in that case, we cannot kind of count that as a negative word. So that is why, that is where this scoring mechanism comes into picture. So this is how they have created a dictionary internally. I have taken one snap for dictionary. Good, great, awesome, terrible. And finally, what happens when you are past this? Sushi was great, food was awesome, but the service was terrible. So they will just take the score 1.2 plus 1.7 minus 2.1. Score is greater than 0, positive. If it is less than 0, negative. So that is how internally they will be measuring the polarity of your sentences, and they will be doing the calculation for these particular sentiments. So till here, anybody is having any doubt how the sentiment of for the review? It is very easy, not big, not much rocket science is there. It is just a basic maths they do, addition, subtraction, and they are able to find out the polarity of the particular review. So this is about how we see the reviews. Now I have added few slides which are called as classifier applications. So now classifier is something which divide any data into the two classes. So you have seen till now the classifiers onto the numerical data, credit card problem, disease, no disease problem, and wine problem or some other type of problems. Today I have shown you sentimental analysis where you are doing positive, negative. That is also a certain sort of kind of a classifier. So similarly, this is also a classifier. So similarly, we have multiple applications of classifier. You can create a classifier which can classify the pages into educational page, finance page, or technology page. So basically, you have to read whole data, and you can create a classifier by using naive Bayes algorithm by doing the tagging that, okay, if it is an education or finance or technology website, this document is talking about which kind of website. Spam filtering, spam or not spam, we have already seen into the naive Bayes example. Naive Bayes classifier is based on this spam filtering. It is also a kind of classifier. Now image classification. So another application of your classifiers are image classification. So basically, you can classify if it is a dog or if it is a cat photo. Within the dog, you can find out the breed, if it is a Dalmatian, if it is a golden retriever, labrador, redbone, bloodhound. So that also classification can be done. So that is an area where it comes into computer vision. Data processing techniques are different, but classification definition remains same across all the kind of classifiers. So this is another type of classifier. Then this is also image based classifier. Okay, disease classifier model, we have seen this diabetes data set. So that is also another kind of classifier. Then this is a image based, so hammer and house. So basically, when you are sleeping, then there is a certain kind of scan for your brain, which is called as hammer. When you are awake, your scan will come into different type. So for detecting the people who are in coma, how much activity they have into their brain, they're also in health domain, these kind of classification models are getting used. So they have nothing to do with the sentimental analysis, but yes, these are all the classifiers available. And these are all the your applications of the classifiers. So another, we have discussed about our positive, negative anyways. So now, suppose only two words had non-zero weight. So basically, score of X is weightage into your number of times the word occurring minus 1.5. Again, weightage into number of times the word occurring. Sushi was awesome. The food was awesome. But the service was awful. So 1.0 into 2 times awesome came. Minus 1.5 into 1 time awful came. So that is how this calculation happens when there is a repetition into the words. Okay. So now you can set up the threshold, like scoring you can do like, okay, greater than zero, you will be taking it as a negative, or positive, less than zero, you will be taking it as a negative. Equal to zero, you can mention that review is neutral review. So neutral condition will never come into your system because dictionary is designed in such a way that very less chance that neutral will come. But yes, sometimes neutral condition can also occur. If you are having one word good and another one bad, then only this condition will be occurring. Otherwise, mostly you will never be getting the condition where the new review will be coming as a neutral. So, okay. So now basically for understanding remaining part, I have to walk you through the code. So I'll tell you what kind of analysis we are doing. So I'll be showing you the analysis via the Twitter website. Okay. So how to do the analysis on Twitter. So Twitter based sentimental analysis. It is a generic code. Anybody can do any kind of analysis by using this particular code, which I will be sharing with you. So Twitter based sentimental analysis. Now there are few things. Okay. First thing is to read the data from Twitter. Okay, so reading the data from the Twitter, you will be requiring one API which is called as Tweepy. Okay, so this Tweepy API is open source and freely available from the Twitter, where Twitter gives this API for the academic purpose that, okay, you can use this API and freely you can download up to 500 GB of data. Okay, so up to 500 GB of data you can download, and this data is only read only. Okay, so you can only read through this API, you cannot write anything. Okay, so writing is not possible, only reading is possible. So this is a read only API. It will give you the customer ID, tweet text, what is the text of the tweet, what is the customer ID, what is the date, and what is the location, and all that. So many things it particular thing, API will give you. Now what happens, what you have to do if you want to do the Twitter based analysis, first thing is you have to create an account on Twitter. Okay, so after creating your account, you will be able to, you have to follow some steps. On Google there are steps given how to install Tweepy API in Python. You can see that you have, if your Twitter account is not there, Tweepy cannot be installed. First you have to create your Twitter account, then you have to do the run the steps for creating your Tweepy API. Once you will be running Tweepy API, when you will be installing, it will generate few codes which will be generated onto the UI of the Twitter itself when you will be following that. So it will give you something called as access token. Okay, and similarly some four values it will give you, so which are called as consumer key, consumer secret, access token, and access token secret. So these four numbers it will generate for you and it will give you. Those numbers you have to put here where I have put XXXX. Now why I am putting XXXX? If these numbers, if somebody else will get, they will be able to handle your Twitter account via the codes. Okay, so better never to show these kind of codes which you are getting from the Twitter. This will be your unique and it will be personal to you. Suppose if I get that code, I can do all the extraction from the Twitter account of your whatever account you are managing. from that particular thing. So you have to make sure that these keys are not shared with anyone. Okay, now just one second, I'll just show you one more thing. TP API, I will show you. So, okay. So, if you are seeing on the screen, this is the link. This link I am sharing with you. Anyways, if you will just search on Google, you will be getting it. But if you will not be able to get it, then in that case, note it down. Okay. So, this link you go, they will just tell you how to install. Okay. So, introduction, API modules. So, here you have something, authentication tutorial, installation tutorial. So, they will tell you all those things, how you have to run and how you have to install it. Okay. Streaming with TP. So, all API references, everything is written about TP into this. But in a basic fundamental way, I am just telling you, it is a simple API used for extracting the data from Twitter. Now, deep in, if you want to go, you can read all this TP documentation available. Just run pip install TP into your terminal and you will be able to install TP API. Now, after you will install the TP API, how to run it, I am telling you. Now, what happens? This much of code snippet, okay, I have taken it from this website itself. Okay, so this is a methodology which will tell you how you can call this API, how you can run this particular API. So I will be passing my data, then I am doing the authorization, then there will be a authorization happening from the Twitter website. So all these will be internal authorization which will happen, and finally you will be getting your object of TP into this API variable. Now, after doing this, this is just a nothing to understand in this. This is just given by directly from the Twitter website itself. So you have to directly blindly run this. Now, search term. So here you will be writing which particular term you want to search about. So what will happen? Suppose if I'm writing about Amitabh Bachchan. So here if I'll type Amitabh Bachchan, then what it will do, TP API will go into my account and it will try to read all the tweets where this keyword is coming, Amitabh Bachchan. Okay, so it will be keep on extracting all those tweets where Amitabh Bachchan is coming. Wherever Amitabh Bachchan is not coming, those tweets it will not copy. Suppose you want to do the analysis for Reliance. You want to understand how Reliance is performing. Then you have to write here Reliance. When you will write here Reliance, it will only extract the tweets where Reliance keyword will be found. Okay. So number of search terms. So here you have to write how many tweets you want to search. So you want to search 100 tweets, 200 tweets, 1000 tweets, 10,000 tweets. More will be the number of tweets, better will be your results. Okay. So here you will be giving the number. Now this line is here what you are doing, TP API. Here you are passing the search term API.search. So what I am saying, you have to do the search. I am saying you have to go and do the search via this API. What you have to search? This particular term. This term is coming from here, this variable. And language is English. So here multiple language Twitter supports Spanish, English, German, French, Mandarin, and multiple languages. So you can mention here that particular language and then you will be able to, it will only be extracting the tweets from that particular language. So that is also one facility available into TP API. Now, number of terms. So, how many number of tweets you want to download, you have to define here. So, remember, suppose you have written, for example, 1000 tweets. Now, what will happen? On your website, on whole Twitter, only 900 tweets are available. Now, what will happen? Your TP API will be keep on waiting. It will be keep on into the listening mode, and until unless a new person will type a tweet about Amitabh Bachchan, then it will read it and it will increase the count 901. So better not to write many tweets, because many tweets, if you will write a lot of time, first of all, it will take, because it will go and search onto the whole timeline. And another thing is, if it is not available, it will be keep on into the listening mode. So that is a problem. And not more, no more than 500 GB data you can download in one time. Another thing is, I am just creating a CSV file where all these tweets, whichever are coming, I am storing. So I am just writing into the append mode. So all the tweets will be collected into a CSV file. Now I am creating some variable polarity. Polarity, positive, weakly positive, strongly positive, negative, weakly negative, strongly negative, neutral. Okay, so these variables I have designed, which I will be using into the below code. Now, what I am doing for tweets in cell tweets, first of all, what I am doing, the cleaning of the tweets. So cleaning of the tweets is basically there are internally cleaning functions are available into your Tweepy API. What it will do, it will remove the comma, exclamation marks, smileys from your tweets and all that. And it will be just giving the pure text available for your analysis. Now, you will be passing your data into all these tweets finally, which are cleaned tweets. You will be passing it into the text blob package. Why we will be passing into text blob? You are converting it into the text blob data type because Tweepy API consumes the data which is into the text blob format. So we have converted into TF-IDF example in text blob type. So similarly, you have to convert this data structure into text blob type. Now, there is one function which is called as sentiment.polarity. So this sentiment.polarity function is available into the text blob library, which will be giving you finally the polarity of that tweet. And how it will be calculating the polarity? Your scoring method. So these equations which we have discussed here, this is how your polarity of the tweet will be calculated. Now, this polarity will be belonging from -1 to +1 always. So now what I'm doing, I'm doing here bucketing. So what I'm writing, if the polarity is equal to 0, neutral is equal to neutral plus 1. If polarity is between 0 to 0.3, then say weakly positive is equal to plus 1. If polarity is 0.3 to 0.6, then positive review. If polarity is 0.6 to 1, then strongly positive. Similarly, minus 0.320, weakly negative, then negative, and then strongly negative for minus 1 to 0.6. So now what is happening? Here, this bucketing, I have done as per my will. So you can directly write if score is in 0 and less than 0. So you can here directly write analysis.sentiment.polarity is greater than 0, then positive is equal to 1, less than 0, then negative is equal to plus 1. I have done more bucketing for more or proper result. So up to you how you want to do the polarity depends on your business application as well. Now, what happens? These number of tweets. Which, yes.
Sorry. Are these sentiment and polarity attributes are from the text blob package?
Text blob package. Yes. Yes. Okay.
So it will calculate the polarity by itself. Under
by itself via the method which we have discussed into the slide.
Okay.
So internally they have the dictionary available of good bad words with the scores defined in the text blob package. Okay. So now what I'm doing, number of tweets I have collected, how many tweets are neutral, how many are positive, how many are strongly positive. Now I will be calculating the percentage. So total number of terms positive divided by total number of terms into 100 will give you the percentage. So I want to showcase the results into the percentage formats rather than the count, because if I'll directly show you the count that 100 tweets are weakly positive looks somewhat cluttered and odd. So better I should give the percentage, that these many people are saying percentage, these many people are saying negative. So percentage calculation I have done, and all these prints which you are seeing, so these prints, what I am doing finally in one shot, I am generating this result. Oh, okay. Just 1 minute. Let me run it. Let me run this. Just give me 1 second. Okay. I have to copy the data. Downloads. Okay. So, okay. Share screen. So now what you happens when you will be running it, you will get this output. So enter the keyword tag to search about. I have written Airtel. Enter how many tweets to search. I have written 100 tweets. So how people are reacting on Airtel by analyzing 100 tweets. General report is weakly positive. So people are very less positive about this particular Airtel company. So 16% people are positive, 19% are weakly positive, 3% are strongly positive, 6% are negative, 4% are weakly negative, 1% are strongly negative, 50% are neutral. Okay. So now why this 50% are neutral is coming because I have only taken 100 tweets. You have to at least take 1000 to 10,000 tweets for a good analysis and good result. But the time running, code running time will also increase along with that. So the whole of this report which you are seeing here, this is the same report I have implemented here into the print function, that if polarity is equal equal to 0, then print neutral. If polarity is greater than 0 and less than equal to 0.3, weakly positive. And this same thing result I am plotting here. So this is the report I'm plotting after doing the analysis. So this is how basically your sentimental analysis in a simple terms work via using the TWIP API and your text blob package. Now, interviewer asks what is sentimental analysis or how it is performed. Many students, what they does, they give the answer simply it is happening via the text blob package. But what you have to do, you have to explain the internals, like, okay, this, there are positive good bad words dictionary and there is a functionality of calculating the scores internally, and then you have to give some example and then you have to explain it code wise. So this is all about your sentimental analysis. Nirud, question. Yes, Anirud.
Just a basic question, because maybe just a stupid one, because I'm not using the Twitter. So
Twitter, because even I was not using the Twitter before doing this sentimental analysis. So Twitter has to be used, but yes, ask me, I will try to help you.
Yeah, just a simple thing, because what I know about Twitter is to follow someone, right? It's to follow something. Someone, right?
Yes.
So, for example, you are giving us the example of Airtel. So, sentimental analysis is like what? It analyzes the comments of the user on my tweets or on the Airtel company, something like that, or
okay, the comments of your timeline and also the people whom you are following, their timelines as well.
Okay.
So good question. Okay, I forgot to mention this. So what will happen? Suppose I want to do the stock market analysis for Airtel. So when you want to do the stock market analysis, go on your Twitter account, start following CNBC Business, start following Money Control, start following the handler of Aaj Tak, start following the NSE, National Stock Exchange, BSE, Bombay Stock Exchange, all these things you start following, then you will get better data for your analysis. So that you have to do. So that you have to go and you have to follow those handles where you want to particularly do the analysis. Or suppose if you are doing for some particular celebrity, then follow some critics, the people who are criticizing the films, and film critics and some film stars and some big media houses, you can just follow them. So accordingly, you will be able to collect that particular data from that area. Okay.
So, for example, if I if I follow Airtel through my Twitter account, and I don't like one of the posts like which is shared by the Airtel, okay? So I commented something on that post. So how does analysis work? It check out my comment on that particular post or what? Like that's this is a basic thing. Like I'm
confused. No. It will just go and blindly read all the tweets available onto that particular timeline.
So it doesn't matter whether it is shared by me or someone else.
See, I'll give you one example. Suppose Facebook. Okay, now Facebook, what will happen when you will open this Facebook? It will just read all the things which are available into my timeline. Suppose tab 9. Now it will, because tab 9 I'm following, I'm not following, this is an ad, but suppose tab 9 I'm following, so it will read all these details. Okay, and then what it will do, it will go into tab 9, or for example, Joanne. It will go into the ID of Joanne itself and it will read all the tweets related to Joanne also, whatever she has commented onto the timeline. So everything will be read, but only for the people who are friends of mine, not everybody. So if they are not my friend, then I cannot read.
Thank you.
So you have to follow them, you have to send them the friend request. If he is not your friend, then you cannot read. So suppose if I want to read the data for the Girish, then I have to follow Girish on Twitter. If I'll not be following Girish on the Twitter, I will not be able to read any of his tweets. Another thing is, you can only read the tweets from the timelines. You cannot edit them. You cannot write back onto the Twitter. So it is a one-way communication from the TWIP. TWIP will only give you the outputs. You cannot write anything via the TWIP into the Twitter. Otherwise, it will become a then data issue for other, privacy issue for other people. Yes.
Okay, thank you. Got it.
So now what happens? This Tweepy API commercial version Twitter is selling to a lot of people. So what happens? Many of the marketing companies, stock brokers, they do a lot of sentimental analysis for their products and all that. So they charge some amount and they give in that thing. What happens without following anybody? You can read the Twitter from everybody, read the tweets from everybody's timeline, but that is a paid version. So this is what is the selling point for Twitter. So Twitter says, sir, I have lot of data available. I can give you the data and you pay me the money. So that is what is where Twitter earns the money from the companies by sharing your data. So what happens, suppose Rushang is tweeting about, for example, he wants to go to Thailand and Phuket for visiting next year into the rainy season, summer season. He wants to spend a holiday there. Now what happens? Make My Trip. Make My Trip is a company who is collecting the data from the Twitter. Now, whenever they got these kind of tweets that somebody is looking for the holidays and all that thing, Make My Trip, what they will do, they will just find out this particular user and they will email him, or they will find out their mobile numbers, or they will WhatsApp him, or they will send a message. You book a Thailand trip from us and we will give you 20% discount. There is a very high probability that Rushang will go and take that particular deal. So that is where business increment happens via these kind of analysis. So a lot of business comes with these analysis, by the way.
But how those companies know about these tweets? Like, for example, millions of people like tweets something. Like, if I want to visit United States, I just wrote a line, right? So how that Make My Trip or other sites knows about this? Is there any way? Like, how can they access?
See, first thing is you can mention the keyword terms. Okay, here you are mentioning the terms or not. So you can mention here the term that holiday. So I am mentioning one term. You can mention multiple terms. Okay, holiday, you can mention holiday, traveling, tourism, these terms. So all the tweets which will be having these kind of data coming, they will just take it. So probably Utkarsh or Rushang might be typing in this way, I am thinking for spending a holiday into Phuket. So these keywords will always be available into your tweets, right? So from that keywords, they will only be getting those tweets. They will find out these people. Now, suppose Rushang and Utkarsh both has tweeted that, okay, Rushang has tweeted that I love Thailand, I want, and I'm thinking about spending a holiday for 10 days in next summer. Utkarsh has tweeted, I don't like Thailand at all and I don't want to go there again for holidays. Now what happens when you will be extracting the tweet? Tweet will just search for the term holiday. Both the tweets will come. Then you have to do the sentimental analysis. Because if you will not do sentimental analysis and directly if you will contact me, I will probably abuse them. Okay, that okay, why the hell you are calling me? I don't want to, I hate Thailand, I don't want to go. So this is where the sentimental analysis comes into picture. The people who are positive about that particular thing, that only I will be targeting. So targeted, focused people I will be getting, and out of 100, if 70-80 people will be also able to take my deal, then it's not a bad job. So that is where this is called as digital marketing area or digital analytics and digital data manipulation and all. Yep. So that's all. From my side for that Twitter analysis, because it is not much is there. If you have any questions, you can ask me. Otherwise, I'll share the codes with you. You just generate your Twitter account, your Tweepy account, and finally, after generating your Tweepy installation, you can start using these codes. You can just do the analysis for anything. Okay. So, which kind of algorithm it is? Supervised or unsupervised?
Unsupervised.
Unsupervised.
Okay, why you think it is unsupervised?
We are just clustering the data.
Okay, one person told supervised. So why it is supervised?
I think TaxFlob has a dictionary labeled data for your sentimental analysis.
Okay, so yes, this is correct. That in a way, if you will see on this algorithm internally, it is a supervised algorithm, because what is happening internally, it is trying mapping from the dictionary scores and all that, and then it is learning, because you have mentioned somewhere that okay, this is the score and this should be the output. But what is happening, finally you will be using directly the API. So API itself, when you will be directly consuming, it is an unsupervised algorithm. So when you are explaining into an interview, you have to explain this is an unsupervised algorithm, but the internal mechanism or internal working methodology is a supervised in nature. But still, I will call it as an unsupervised algorithm, because here explicitly I don't have to do anything with respect to tagging and target variable we are not providing. I'm not saying that this tweet is positive or negative. Internally it is calculating via clustering kind of format or scoring, which we have discussed, but it is kind of a supervised internally. So that's the answer for that, correct answer for that. Okay, so any other questions? So this is your basic sentimental analysis. Lot of things are there into text analytics. Apart from this, this is just very basic sentimental analysis. I have told you lot of problems are there: topic modeling, conjoint analysis, and your name entity recognition. Lot of things are there. N-gram technique. So TF-IDF you have already seen. Count vectorizer you already know. So these are the few things, few parts. So go through this code, that's all. Nothing big into this code also, and nothing big into the concept. Just go through it once only for interview purpose, because sentimental analysis, many companies ask, okay, how to do the sentimental analysis. So in that perspective, just go through it once. Otherwise, mostly you have to concentrate on machine learning and statistics part. So that's all from my side for today's class. So if you have any questions, please ask. Otherwise, I'll wrap it up.
Surendra, yeah, I have one generalized question regarding machine learning algorithms.
Okay.
Like, after building everything, the algorithms and getting the score, how do you deploy this model?
Okay, so there are multiple places where a model can be deployed. So for example, I can just deploy the model and integrate the model into the backend of my website. Okay, I can create a UI and into the backend I can integrate it. Another thing is I can deploy it onto the cloud. Okay, so on cloud system, my model will be keep on running. Whenever any new customer will be coming, I will be just hitting this particular API, this model will generate the output. And in your internal existing systems also, you can deploy the models for the prediction purpose, where you will be using recommendations and all. So depends on that. So for example, this sentimental analysis, company might be creating a UI, and backend this model will be running, and UI they will be showing you the outputs. You will be just, so they will be showing you this kind of UI. So in UI, what you are doing, for example, in UI, okay, it's very slow. What happened? Okay, I don't know what happened in this. Okay, so in UI, what they will do, probably they will give you this block. They will ask you write your search term, write your number of tweets, and they will give you the output. So on the back end, this model can be integrated. So depends on company to company, what application they are using, accordingly they will be deploying and integrating. Okay.
So is it part of this, like, as you are an ML engineer, is it part of your job to develop it?
It's not my part, it is a DevOps part. So DevOps people do that. So there is a team for integration and DevOps. So these people do that. But if you know this, it is an additional weightage, because nowadays what I'm seeing, people expect that you should know DevOps also, little bit of DevOps. So because at least some things on cloud deployment you should know. So that is required, yes. But not our job perspective, not our job description. If you want to learn it extra, it will be an additional weightage, good thing, but not actually people will be expecting from you.
Suppose if the interviewer asks, but, how do you deploy your model?
Then if you don't know, then you can directly tell them that, okay, I just give it to DevOps team, they deploy it. I don't do deployment thing.
Okay.
But you can tell them ki where to deploy. We can deploy it onto the via Flask API, via using this cloud Docker files and all. Same little bit you can read. I think you have one class available for that, Spark classes. There you will learn that. Big data classes are there. They will teach you how to deploy a model. And even there you will be having one class for pipelining and model deployment. So they will tell you in detail like how to do those deployments. So that much is enough. Okay, more than enough.
Okay, thank you, Utkarsh.
But deployment is very company specific. Every company uses different kind of function. SAP is a tool where you can deploy the model. IBM DataCap is a tool where you can deploy the model. Twitter is a website where you can deploy your model. Amazon is a website where you can deploy your model. So every company is having different scenarios. I am working into a bank. In the bank infrastructure, I deploy the model. So very company specific it is. Okay. So that's how it works. But one generic way will be told to you by somebody who will be taking your pipeline class. One class is there, I know, for that, for you. So, okay. So, yeah. Yes, Girish.
Can you explain this CSV file, open result.csv, and before writing, what the path will be there?
Path is the current working directory.
It will pick it up for the CSV writer as well.
CSV writer is writing the data into the CSV file. So I have created one CSV file, opened one CSV file into the append mode. I will be keep on appending the data into that, and whatever tweets I am collecting, that I will be keep on writing into the result.csv file. So that's how I have created it. So you can actually finally what you can do, whatever tweets you have collected, you can open this result.csv file. You can read all those tweets into this file. So if you will mention some path, in that path it will be created. If you will not mention the path, it will create into the current working directory. Okay. So, okay.